I am your host, Charles Fry, and I will be telling you today about how easy it is to instrument weights and biases with PyTorch. So this is now, once we've now got to the training logic, now this is where weights and biases really starts to come into play. The two functions are watch and log. So watch is a special function that's especially useful with PyTorch models. It will log the gradients and the parameters of your model every certain number of steps of training. So you can set that number there, how often you want to log the gradients in the models. I tend to use something like 10, 100, something like that. If it's every epoch, I might log it every epoch. So that's this first line here at the beginning of our train function. I say, hey, yo, we're about to start training this model. Wandb, watch that model. This section here then runs training. And down here, I've got this function train batch. That's what really defines the actual training logic. All this stuff around here is just, okay, I'm counting examples and batches. I'm loading the images and labels. I'm using TQDM to give me a nice progress bar. So the two important pieces are train batch and train log. So train batch is the part where we actually do the training. This is standard PyTorch stuff. Put my images and my labels on my device, run a forward pass that gets me the outputs and the loss, run a backwards pass, and then take a step with my optimizer. So improve the performance of my model at the end, and then return the loss for later use. So we've got this train batch function that's all quite standard. The part that differs is the part where we log what's going on in training. And the code that I wrote before I discovered weights and biases, this would be something like a print statement maybe, or maybe saving something to a file locally would be this train log function. So this is where the difference comes in, this wandb.log call. So what this does is says, hey, WNB, here is the information that I want to associate with this step of training. First, you should give a step number. Okay, what step of training is this? And this should be constantly going up as you're going. So it doesn't have to go up by one every time. So for example, here I'm using the number of images that the neural network has seen as my step. The other thing to provide is this dictionary here, a dictionary that says, oh, okay, here's what happened on this step of training. The epoch was this number and the loss was this. This dictionary here, you can put lots of things in it, much more complicated things than just numbers, using the various wandb media types, images, audio, video, 3D objects, things like that can also be logged here. But to keep this example simple, I'll just stick with these sort of simple scalar values here. So that's the main difference here. All of this code up here, this is stuff apart from this wandb.watch here, all of this stuff is standard. So really we've only added this line here and this line here. So now that we've defined the three components of our pipeline, make, train, and test, we've built our pipeline and we've instrumented it with WNB. We've added those four or five lines. We're ready to run our fully tracked experiment. I'm going to run this cell here and then we're going to see what comes out. When you start a run with weights and biases, we give you a couple of links to a project page, which is where you can group together a bunch of runs that are all in the same project, and then to a run page, which is a specific page for this particular run that's gonna log information about that run here. Let's go and check that out and let's see what we logged. All right, what this thing is here, you might hear this called the workspace or the dashboard. This is where you can interact with all of your runs, the information that was logged from each run. But what we've got here, because we use wandb.watch, we've got the values for all of our weights, biases, and the values for the gradients over time. So you can see some nice things like the gradients aren't exploding or vanishing. The gradients are decreasing over time. That's a good sign for optimization. This is very useful for debugging. It's presented as a histogram. At any given point on the x-axis, there is a histogram. And then you can highlight an individual histogram to see what that individual histogram looks like in greater detail. You can see a little kernel density estimate on top of it if you prefer a kernel density estimate to a histogram. This also includes the things that we logged ourselves, the things that we logged by hand with wandb.log. So right here, we've got the loss. It's going down over time. That's good. There's a good amount of noise here because I think this is just the loss on an individual batch. So that can be quite noisy. It's only 100 or so examples. It's noisy, but it's going down. If you want to get rid of some of the noise in one of your charts, if you really actually care more about the trend over time, you can use this smoothing operation. So that looks like about the right amount of smoothing to capture the fact that we're really, you know, we're going down here. And you can always include or not include the original in your chart when you're showing these smooth versions here.